The Fabian Society was actually named after a Roman general called Fabius, and his claim to fame was never having battles with the enemy that could prove decisive either way. His method of taking over was to weaken and weaken and weaken the enemy over a period of time, and then when they were so weak to resist, then move in. That is precisely what the system is doing. It's making us weaker and weaker, well, people that go with it at the moment, weaker and weaker by the food we eat, the water we drink, by the electromagnetic fields that we come into, by economic suppression and manipulation. All these things are being done to weaken and weaken and weaken the target population, Fabius style, so eventually they think they can just walk in when we're too weak to resist. That's the bloody idea. Physical control. I'll get through this pretty quick. Physical control. Okay, major aspect of physical control. Take over the countries. This is not a map, it's a wish list. It's a wish list of countries in North Africa, the Middle East, and the Near East, which they are picking off one after the other. Libya, now they're into Syria, and they're starting trouble in Lebanon, they're in Iraq, they're in Afghanistan. Of course, they want Iran. And what they're doing is they're finding different excuses to pick off different countries, because they have to find different excuses, or people might think that there's a pattern here. This is Libya looked like in 2007. This is what the same street looks like in 2011. This is Libya. Hey, you are free. And this is what happens when you pepper bomb cities to protect civilians from violence. What happened? I got no brief for bloody Gaddafi and all that stuff, but that's not the point. What happened was that they've got this system where they want to target someone. So what they do is they fund and train rebels covertly, and they bloody arm them. And then they get the rebels to start shooting at government targets. Political response, shh. Media response, shh. Then the governments start shooting back at the rebels. Political response, they're shooting and killing your own people. Media response, the same. Oh, we've got to send people in, humanitarian. And in come the de facto bloody world army, NATO, dropping bombs everywhere. And now they're doing the same in bloody Syria. Not a Syrian civil war, it's a mercenary bloody war. That's what that is. You know, NATO bloody weapons here in the boxes for them. And you know, neocon organization, the Project for the New American Century, it was behind the Bush administration. And September 2000, before the Bush administration came in, it produced a document which called for the incoming Bush administration and America to fight, quote, multiple theaters of war. In places like Libya and Syria and all these countries. But it said in the document, in September 2000, but this process of transformation, this takeover of country after country, was likely to be a long one, absent some catastrophic and catalyzing event like a new Pearl Harbor. 1 year to the month, after that document was published, 9 months after the same people came to power in the Bush administration, the United States had what Bush called our Pearl Harbor, and as a result, they justified the targeting of all the countries that were in that document. This is a man called General Wesley Clark, and he said this in a television interview. This is not God's gift of peace either. He led the NATO attacks in the former Yugoslavia, but he said in a television interview in 2007 that immediately after 9/11, he was told that a coup was being plotted by Dick Cheney, vice president then, Don Rumsfeld, defense secretary, Paul Wolfowitz, Defense Secretary Deputy, and what he called a half a dozen other collaborators from the Project for the New American Century that included an invasion of Iraq. 6 weeks later, he said, he was back with the guy, and he saw the same officer, and he said, why haven't we attacked Iraq? Are we still going to attack Iraq? And this officer said to him, this is again, you know, after 9/11, 6 weeks, sir, it's worse than that. The officer pulled up a piece of paper off his desk and said, I just got this memo from the Secretary of Defense's office. It says we're going to attack and destroy the governments in 7 countries in 5 years. We're going to start with Iraq, and then we're going to move to Syria, Lebanon, Libya, Somalia, Sudan, and Iran. And Clark said the aim of the plot was they wanted us to destabilize the Middle East, turn it upside down, and make it under our control. And that is the agenda that's been followed, and all these excuses to pick off country over country are just that, bloody excuses.
And they say if we'll only avoid any direct confrontation with the enemy, they call their policy accommodation. And they say if we'll only avoid any direct confrontation with the enemy, they call their policy accommodation. Because to save our own skins, we're willing to make a deal with your slave masters. Your slave masters. Because to save our own skins, we're willing to make a deal with your slave masters. There's only one guaranteed way you can have peace. Surrender. There's only one guaranteed way you can have peace. Surrender. And therein lies the road to war. And therein lies the road to war. Because to save our own skins, we're willing to make a deal with your slave masters. Deliver the final ultimatum.
By any means necessary.
There is a price we will not pay. There is a point beyond which they must not advance.
By any means necessary.
To deliver the final ultimatum.
By any means necessary.
There is a price we will not pay. There is a point beyond which they must not advance. There's only one guaranteed way you can have peace. Surrender. There's only one guaranteed way you can have peace. Surrender. And therein lies the road to war. The martyrs of history were not fools. The martyrs of history were not fools. By committing an immorality so great, eventually we have to face the final demand, the ultimatum. Eventually we have to face the final demand, the ultimatum.
And of course, one of the things they want is to get to the China and Russian border. They want a third world war with China and Russia. been in their documents for ages. And so what we're seeing are these people going through the Middle East using different excuses to pick off their target countries. You know, oh, America stands for freedom. We want to protect Brazilians. We only care about peace. Ah, only kidding. She's Hillary speaking. No, I just love it. Ooh, yes, I love it. Syria next, kill them. Oh, I love it. There you are, that's bloody NATO. There you go, I like that. So we look at Iran. We look at Iran, and this is how many wars they have instigated or fought since the Second World War. Actually, that's how many they've instigated and instigated for about 200 bloody years. This is how many the USA has fought with Britain in tag most of the bloody time since the Second World War. These are American bases around Iran. Who's threatening who, one wonders? Iranians are just the same as you and me. People just want to get on with their lives and their families and all the rest of it. But let's demonize them. Let's demonize them and let's bomb them. Why? We have no heart. We love death. These bloody pillocks doing all this stuff. Violent extremists. Yeah, look in the bloody mirror. Look at them. Talk about inversion. The bloody terrorists fighting terrorism. I love it. War is peace. Slavery is freedom. Ignorance is strength. What is that? Archontic inversion. It's all a bloody movie that we're coming through, and it's all leading up to World War III. I'm not going to go into this in bloody detail because of time, but Rothschild Zionism, which is actually not about Jewish people, it's about a secret society created and instigated and controlled by the Rothschilds that the Jewish people has used as the bloody front to cover the real thing about Rothschild Zionism, which is it's a bloody secret society and part of the cabal. But the Rothschilds, you know, named after Saturn and all this stuff, they built the Knesset, they built the Supreme Court building, and what they do is that they anyone that challenges the Rothschilds and Rothschild Zionism and its agenda, they are called anti-Semitic and all this stuff. As this lady says, anti-Zionism is not anti-Semitism, and even bloody Orthodox Jewish rabbis are saying the bloody same. You don't have to be a Jewish to be a Zionist. That's what Joe Biden said. Absolutely you don't. Most bloody great, you know, Zionists in America are Christian bloody Zionists, believing bloody Armageddon. And you get Orthodox Jews that absolutely oppose Zionism. You know, another Jew against Zionism. I'm Jewish and I want Israel to stop killing Palestinians. Jews against the occupation. These are wonderful Jewish young people that refuse... These are wonderful Jewish young people who refuse to serve in the military and do this to Palestinian bloody kids. That's what we need. How many people know that this is going on between Jewish people and Ahmadinejad? Eh? How many people know this is going on? This is the dynamic between a country of 300 plus million and one of less than 8 million. Why? Because the Rothschilds are the controllers of Israel and they're controllers of the USA and they're different hands on the same bloody body. And it's all this money that's handed by America to Israel. It ain't going to the rank and file Israelis. This is 400,000 people on the streets of Israel last year because of their economic situation. Two people at least have set fire to themselves in bloody protest. And what we bloody need so much is for the people of Israel who are being suppressed by their bloody hierarchy come together in common cause with Palestinians and Americans and British and Australians and Africans who are being suppressed by their hierarchy. And realize that all those hierarchies are the same frickin' hierarchy. Let's come together. It's their worst bloody nightmare. This is why America and Israel work as one unit. They're both controlled by the same bloody lot. This is why he won't say a word or any other president when this mayhem and slaughter is going on. What's happening in Palestine is frickin' genocide. No other word for it. genocide, the systematic and widespread extermination or attempted extermination of an entire national, racial, religious or ethnic group. This is Rothschild Zionism. This is Rothschild Zionism. So is bloody this. All the time, Palestinian homes, often for generations, bulldozed to make way for these bloody fanatics and these bloody crazies in the military and government. Yeah, we're going to build a wall. We're going to take the land. No one's going to say anything. This is bloody Israel. Controlled by the Rothschilds. No one says no to the Rothschilds. They know the consequences. Hey, Palestinian children's playground. We want it for our wall. Genocide. Bloody genocide. This is Palestinian land, the green, in 1946, 1947, 1967. Today, genocide, the systematic and widespread extermination or attempted extermination of an entire national, racial, religious, or ethnic group. This is going on before our eyes. We'd never let it happen again. We're watching it happen again. The bloody Zion, bloody Olympics, new bloody Jerusalem, Zion. This is not even about Jewish people and the benefits. They were hung out to dry in bloody Germany. They'll be hung out to dry again whenever it suits these people. That's the bloody thing. The elephant in the living room. And people are terrified of talking about it because all the Anti-Defamation League and these Rothschild fronts jump on you. Anti-Semite, racist. They've tried it with me. But when you're saying we're all infinite awareness, having an experience, and the genetic spacesuit is fucking irrelevant, well, it's very difficult to make it stick. And even if it does, I don't bloody give a shit. So, we have this, and we have this, and yet we must be scared of Iran. Personally, I think it's more likely we should be scared of America and Britain, myself. Rothschild Zionism want to take us, the Rothschilds and Rothschilds, I want to take us into the Third World War. I've been saying this for years. And of course, Armageddon is supposed to come out of the Middle East. Third World War, it's all about death. All of them were Rothschild Zionists in the Project for the New American Century that orchestrated all this country after country takeover. But this guy, Albert Pike, was a high, high Freemason in America. And he wrote a letter, it said, some would say it's a forgery, or a fake. Well, my God, I tell you what, these fakes and forgeries don't often tell a bloody tale with the hindsight of history. That's actually turned out to be true. Albert Pike, letter to Giuseppe Mazzini in 1871, he talked about three world wars coming, so that and each one would go towards eventually taking over the world. And he talked about the First World War and the Second World War and how the Second World War would create a homeland for what he called political Zionism. And then he said this about the Third World War. The Third World War must be fomented by taking advantage of the differences caused by the agentura of the Illuminati, the network, the bloodlines, between the political Zionist, Israel in other words, and leaders of the Islamic world. The war must be conducted in such a way that Islam, the Muslim Arabic world, and political Zionism, the state of Israel, because they knew that was coming even then, mutually destroy each other. Meanwhile, note that, mutually destroy each other. Are you listening, people of Israel? Meanwhile, the other nations, once more divided on this issue, will be constrained to fight to the point of complete physical, moral, and spiritual and economical exhaustion. And then he was pointing out that then they would move in and say, we can save everything, but you have to do what we say, and they have to do it the way we say it. And if it becomes a nuclear war, then changing the atmosphere is a bonus. Are we going to roll this back? Or are we going to wait until it's got really, really extreme? By which time there'll be so much infrastructure in place that drawing a line in the sand will be a serious challenge. You know, if you read Orwell's book, 1984, you know, Big Brother was not focusing attention on controlling the whole of the population or monitoring the whole of the population primarily, because most of the population would just sit there and stew anyway. And were no problem to this control. But what this surveillance was targeting, and what surveillance is targeting now, are people who are challenging the system, people who are becoming aware of what's going on and having the guts to try to do something about it.
out my window, it seems gray again, but I can't get down. Cause I know it's by design, the government keeping in line, geoengineering on a dime. Can't control my passion, can't control my heat, can't control my emotion, G. Can't control a single factor that makes a free man still bleed. Myself thinking, no, 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 he doesn't. Cause I'm coming out to take my guns by frozen. You don't know when it's gonna come to show, and all the blood is gonna blow. Keeping perspective through Facebook. The Central Intelligence Agency's a bunch of crooks. Nothing I really care. In my heart, in my stare, come get a little because life ain't fair.
We're up against the wall. We must stand tall. We look up, knowing what's love.
No, we really never know what we lose until it's too late, and all we can do is look back again and wonder what could have been, but never really could have spent. The right time, the right emotion, it just is all a notion. It seems that it's convulsions. Maybe it could have been different, but probably not, because all I am is gifted. Wanna check the news, wanna check the media, wanna check everything that's beating you. All you wanted to do was watch society's output for me and you, the tube. And it was confliction, but in the end, I was left gifted. A chance to rise a little higher, a chance to make my voice a little higher.
We're up against the
situation by looking the other way, by getting caught in all the diversions of life. You look over here while we do something over here and you don't see because you're watching the game or whatever. We got into this situation by not paying attention. All right, there's been a lot of manipulation to make us not pay attention, but the responsibility is still with us. We've not. We've also gone through this process of, well, if it doesn't affect me, it's not my problem. But when you do that, eventually it does become your problem. And that's what we're seeing now. So please, people, those that have not been paying attention, those that have been looking the other way, those that have been saying, oh, it's not my problem because it doesn't affect me immediately, look at what's happening as a result of that. We need to change. We need to start paying attention. We need to start getting involved, and we start to realize that everybody's injustice is our injustice, because if it's not, in the end it will be, when they've picked up all these other groups in society, all these other nations, all these other income brackets, colors and creeds and religions. There'll be a knock on your door, and who's going to be there to speak for you? Well, there is no one left, because they've picked all the others off while you were looking the other way, saying it's not my problem. What we need to do very, very urgently is to put aside all these irrelevant divisions that are put there to divide and rule us. Religion, income bracket, color, creed, culture, and all the rest of it, so that we come together in unity and realize that this is an attack on the freedom, the basic freedom of all of us, Muslim, Jew, Christian, atheist, whatever, and on the children and grandchildren that have to live in the world that we are leaving them. And if anyone thinks their religion is more important than that, or their bloody politics is more important than that, or their income bracket, color, creed, whatever is more important than that, then you are a disgrace. And you are in such a closed, concrete-minded state, it takes my breath away. Now, come on. We've been going along this road for long enough, and look where it got us. We have to change. We have to start putting down the fault lines of division and realize we're all in this together. Because they're playing now in the Middle East, Sunni Muslims off against Shiite Muslims, just as they played Muslims off against Christians, and Jews off against Christians and Muslims, and all the rest of it, like they play Republicans off against Democrats when they're two masks on the same face. We have to change, because if we don't, what they want will unfold, and what they want is absolutely horrific. It's time to stop being children in adult bodies and start to stand up together and face this. And if we do, we can bring it to an end, because we have the numbers. There are 7 billion plus in this world, divided and ruled through all these fault lines I'm talking about, but there is a handful, comparatively, of people at the core who are orchestrating all of this. Now, we, the 7 billion, have not come together in unity because the few have divided and ruled us and set us at war with each other. Economic competition, military competition, competition for dominance of religion and belief system. When we let that go, the unity of the mass of the people can swamp the pinprick number at the core of the core who are orchestrating this. Time is now. Fork in the road is in front of us, and we have no time left to decide which way to go. Well, if you can't put your differences aside, I tell you what we ought to do. Tell you what we'll do. When people are in the concentration camps, and when their children and grandchildren are having every detail of their lives, even their thoughts, dictated by this global tyranny that's unfolding, I tell you what we should do. We should all sit around, before they take us to bring an end to us all together, we should all sit around and we should have a debate on who had the best religion, who had the best politics, who had the best belief system, who had the most money. That's what we can do. That'd be a great idea, wouldn't it?
And then we can have
that
a riot.
That has to happen now.
Yeah.
It has to end now, because if it doesn't, a nightmare scenario is going to unfold. It has to happen now. And if people aren't prepared to do it, don't complain when the nightmare...
Now, the Fabian Society was actually named after a Roman general called Fabius, and his claim to fame was never having battles with the enemy that could prove decisive either way. His method of taking over was to weaken and weaken and weaken the enemy over a period of time, and then when they were so weak to resist, then move in. That is precisely what the system is doing. It's making us weaker and weaker, well, people that go with it at the moment, weaker and weaker by the food we eat, the water we drink, by the electromagnetic fields that we come into, by economic suppression and manipulation. All these things are being done to weaken and weaken and weaken the target population, Fabius style, so eventually they think they can just walk in when we're too weak to resist. That's the bloody idea. Physical control. I'll get through this pretty quick. Physical control, okay, major aspect of physical control, take over the countries. This is not a map, it's a wish list. It's a wish list of countries in North Africa, in the Middle East and the Near East, which they are picking off one after the other. Libya, now they're into Syria, they're starting trouble in Lebanon, they're in Iraq, they're in Afghanistan, of course they want Iran. And what they're doing is they're finding different excuses to pick off different countries, because they have to find different excuses, or people might think that there's a pattern here. This is what Libya looked like in 2007. This is what the same street looks like in 2011. This is Libya. Hey, you are free. And this is what happens when you pepper bomb cities to protect civilians from violence. What happened? I got no brief for bloody Gaddafi and all that stuff, but that's not the point. What happened was that they've got this system where they want to target someone. So what they do is they fund and train rebels covertly, and they bloody arm them. And then they get the rebels to start shooting at government targets. Political response, shh. Media response, shh. Then the governments start shooting back at the rebels. Political response, they're shooting and killing your own people. Media response, the same. Oh, we've got to send people in, humanitarian. And in come the de facto bloody world army, NATO, dropping bombs everywhere. And now they're doing the same in bloody Syria. Not a Syrian civil war, it's a mercenary bloody war. That's what that is. You know, NATO bloody weapons here in the boxes for them. And you know neocon organization, the Project for the New American Century, it was behind the Bush administration. And in September 2000, before the Bush administration came in, it produced a document which called for the incoming Bush administration and America to fight, quote, multiple theaters of war in places like Libya and Syria and all these countries. But it said in the document in September 2000, but this process of transformation, this takeover of country after country, was likely to be a long one, absent some catastrophic and catalyzing event like a new Pearl Harbor. 1 year to the month after that document was published, 9 months after the same people came to power in the Bush administration, the United States had what Bush called our Pearl Harbor, and as a result, they justified the targeting of all the countries that were in that document. This is a man called General Wesley Clark, and he said this in a television interview. This is not God's gift to peace either. He led the NATO attacks in the former Yugoslavia. But he said in a television interview in 2007 that immediately after 9/11, he was told that a coup was being plotted by Dick Cheney, vice president then, Don Rumsfeld, Defense Secretary, Paul Wolfowitz, Defense Secretary Deputy, and what he called a half a dozen other collaborators from the Project for the New American Century that included an invasion of Iraq. 6 weeks later, he said, he was back with the guy, and he saw the same officer, and he said, why haven't we attacked Iraq? Are we still going to attack Iraq? And this officer said to him, this is again, you know, after 9/11, 6 weeks, sir, it's worse than that. The officer pulled up a piece of paper off his desk and said, I just got this memo from the Secretary of Defense's office. It says we're going to attack and destroy the governments in 7 countries in 5 years. We're going to start with Iraq, and then we're going to move to Syria, Lebanon, Libya, Somalia, Sudan, and Iran. And Clark said the aim of the plot was they wanted to destabilize the Middle East, turn it upside down, and make it under our control. And that is the agenda that's been followed, and all these excuses to pick off country over country are just that, bloody excuses.
And they say if we'll only avoid any direct confrontation with the enemy, they call their policy accommodation. And they say if we'll only avoid any direct confrontation with the enemy, they call their policy accommodation. Because to save our own skins, we're willing to make a deal with your slave masters. Your slave masters. Because to save our own skins, we're willing to make a deal with your slave masters. There's only one guaranteed way you can have peace. Surrender. There's only one guaranteed way you can have peace. Surrender. And therein lies the road to war. And therein lies the road to war. Because to save our own skins, we're willing to make a deal with your slave masters.
By any means necessary.
To deliver the final ultimatum.
By any means necessary.
There is a price we will not pay. There is a point beyond which they must not advance.
By any means necessary.
To deliver the final ultimatum.
By any means necessary.
There is a price we will not pay. There is a point beyond which they must not advance. There's only one guaranteed way you can have peace. Surrender. There's only one guaranteed way you can have peace. Surrender. And therein lies the road to war. The martyrs of history were not fools. The martyrs of history were not fools. By committing an immorality so great, eventually we have to face the final demand, the ultimatum. Eventually we have to face the final demand, the ultimatum.
And, of course, one of the things they want is to get to the China and Russian border. They want a Third World War with China and Russia. It's been in their documents for ages. And so what we're seeing are these people going through the Middle East using different excuses to pick off their target countries. You know, oh, America stands for freedom. We want to protect Brazilians. We only care about peace. Ah, only kidding, only kidding. She's Hillary speaking. No, I just love it. Ooh, yes, I love it. Syria next, kill them. Oh, I love it. There you are, that's bloody NATO. There you go, I like that. So we look at Iran. We look at Iran, and this is how many wars they have instigated or fought since the Second World War. Actually, that's how many they've instigated and instigated for about 200 bloody years. This is how many the USA has fought with Britain in tag most of the bloody time since the Second World War. These are American bases around Iran. Who's threatening who, one wonders? Iranians are just the same as you and me. People just want to get on with their lives and their families and all the rest of it. But let's demonize them. Let's demonize them and let's bomb them. Why? We have no heart. We love death. These bloody pillocks doing all this stuff. Violent extremists. Yeah, look in the bloody mirror. Look at them. Talk about inversion. The bloody terrorists fighting terrorism. I love it. War is peace. Slavery is freedom. Ignorance is strength. What is that? Archontic inversion. It's all that bloody movie that we're coming through, and it's all leading up to World War III. I'm not going to go into this in bloody detail because of time, but Rothschild Zionism, which is actually not about Jewish people, it's about a secret society created and instigated and controlled by the Rothschilds that the Jewish people has used as the bloody front to cover the real thing about Rothschild Zionism, which is it's a bloody secret society and part of the cabal. But the Rothschilds, you know, named after Saturn and all this stuff, they built the Knesset, they built the Supreme Court building, and what they do is that they anyone that challenges the Rothschilds and Rothschild Zionism and its agenda, they are called anti-Semitic and all this stuff. As this lady says, anti-Zionism is not anti-Semitism, and even bloody Orthodox Jewish rabbis are saying the bloody same. You don't have to be a Jewish to be a Zionist. That's what Joe Biden said. Absolutely you don't. Most bloody great, you know, Zionists in America are Christian bloody Zionists, believing bloody Armageddon. And you get Orthodox Jews that absolutely oppose Zionism. You know, another Jew against Zionism. I'm Jewish and I want Israel to stop killing Palestinians. Jews against the occupation. These are wonderful Jewish young people that refuse... These are wonderful Jewish young people who refuse to serve in the military and do this to Palestinian bloody kids. That's what we need. How many people know that this is going on between Jewish people and Ahmadinejad? Eh? How many people know this is going on? This is the dynamic between a country of 300 plus million and one of less than 8 million. Why? Because the Rothschilds are the controllers of Israel and they're controllers of the USA and they're different hands on the same bloody body. And it's all this money that's handed by America to Israel. It ain't going to the rank and file Israelis. This is 400,000 people on the streets of Israel last year because of their economic situation. Two people at least have set fire to themselves in bloody protest. And what we bloody need so much is for the people of Israel, who are being suppressed by their bloody hierarchy, come together in common cause with Palestinians and Americans and British and Australians and Africans who are being suppressed by their hierarchy. And realize that all those hierarchies are the same freaking hierarchy. Let's come together. It's their worst bloody nightmare. This is why America and Israel work as one unit. They're both controlled by the same bloody lot. This is why he won't say a word or any other president when this mayhem and slaughter is going on. What's happening in Palestine is frickin' genocide. No other word for it. genocide, the systematic and widespread extermination or attempted extermination of an entire national, racial, religious or ethnic group. This is Rothschild Zionism. This is Rothschild Zionism. So is bloody this. All the time, Palestinian homes, often for generations, bulldozed to make way for these bloody fanatics and these bloody crazies in the military and government. Yeah, we're going to build a wall. We're going to take the land. No one's going to say anything. This is bloody Israel. Controlled by the Rothschilds. No one says no to the Rothschilds. They know the consequences. Hey, Palestinian children's playground. We want it for our war. Genocide. Bloody genocide. This is Palestinian land, the green, in 1946, 1947, 1967. Today, genocide, the systematic and widespread extermination or attempted extermination of an entire national, racial, religious or ethnic group. This is going on before our eyes. We'd never let it happen again. We're watching it happen again. The bloody Zion, bloody Olympics, new bloody Jerusalem, Zion. This is not even about Jewish people and the benefits. They were hung out to dry in bloody Germany. They'll be hung out to dry again whenever it suits these people. That's the bloody thing. The elephant in the living room. And people are terrified of talking about it because all the Anti-Defamation League and these Rothschild fronts jump on you. Anti-Semite, racist. They've tried it with me. But when you're saying we're all infinite awareness, having an experience, and the genetic spacesuit is fucking irrelevant, well, it's very difficult to make it stick. And even if it does, I don't bloody give a shit. So, we have this, and we have this, and yet we must be scared of Iran. Personally, I think it's more likely we should be scared of America and Britain, myself. Rothschild Zionism want to take us, the Rothschilds and Rothschild Zion, want to take us into the Third World War. I've been saying this for years. And of course, Armageddon is supposed to come out of the Middle East. Third World War, it's all about death. All of them were Rothschild Zionists in the Project for the New American Century that orchestrated all this country after country takeover. But this guy, Albert Pike, was a high, high Freemason in America. And he wrote a letter, it said, someone say it's a forgery, or a fake. Well, my God, I tell you what, these fakes and forgeries don't often tell a bloody tale with the hindsight of history. That's actually turned out to be true. Albert Pike, letter to Giuseppe Mazzini in 1871, he talked about three world wars coming, so that and each one would go towards eventually taking over the world. And he talked about the First World War and the Second World War and how the Second World War would create a homeland for what he called political Zionism. And then he said this about the Third World War. The Third World War must be fomented by taking advantage of the differences caused by the agentura of the Illuminati, the network, the bloodlines, between the political Zionist, Israel in other words, and leaders of the Islamic world. The war must be conducted in such a way that Islam, the Muslim Arabic world, and political Zionism, the State of Israel, because they knew that was coming even then, mutually destroy each other. Meanwhile, note that, mutually destroy each other. Are you listening, people of Israel? Meanwhile, the other nations, once more divided on this issue, will be constrained to fight to the point of complete physical, moral, and spiritual and economical exhaustion. And then he was pointing out that then they would move in and say, we can save everything, but you have to do what we say, and they have to do it the way we say it. And if it becomes a nuclear war, then changing the atmosphere is a bonus.
Are we going to roll this back? Or are we going to wait until it's got really, really extreme? By which time there'll be so much infrastructure in place that drawing a line in the sand will be a serious challenge. You know, if you read Orwell's book, 1984, you know, Big Brother was not focusing attention on controlling the whole of the population or monitoring the whole of the population primarily, because most of the population would just sit there and stew anyway. And were no problem to this control. But what this surveillance was targeting, and what the surveillance is targeting now, are people who are challenging the system, people who are becoming aware of what's going on and having the guts to try to do something about it.
looking out my window, it seems gray again, but I can't get down. Cause I know it's by design, the government keeping in line, geoengineering on a dime. Can't control my passion, can't control my heat, can't control my emotion, G. Can't control a single factor that makes a free man still bleed. Myself thinking, no, 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 he doesn't. Cause I'm coming out to take my guns by posing. You don't know when it's gonna come to show, when all the blood is gonna blow. Keeping perspective through Facebook. The Central Intelligence Agency's a bunch of crooks. Not that I really care. In my heart, in my stare, come get a little because life ain't fair.
We're up against the wall. We must stand tall. We look up, knowing what's lost.
No, we really never know what we lose until it's too late, and all we can do is look back again and wonder what could have been, but never really could have spent. The right time, the right emotion, it just is all a notion. It seems that it's convulsions. Maybe it could have been different, but probably not, because all I am is gifted. Wanna check the news, wanna check the media, wanna check everything that's beating you. All you wanted to do is watch society's output for me and you, the tube. And it was confliction, but in the end, I was left gifted. A chance to rise a little higher, a chance to make my voice a little higher.
Religion is more important than that, or their bloody politics is more important than that, or their income bracket, color, creed, whatever is more important than that, then you are a disgrace, and you are in such a closed, concrete-minded state, it takes my breath away. Now, come on. We've been going along this road for long enough, and look where it got us. We have to change. We have to start putting down the fault lines of division and realize we're all in this together. Because they're playing now in the Middle East, Sunni Muslims off against Shiite Muslims, just as they played Muslims off against Christians and Jews off against Christians and Muslims and all the rest of it, like they played Republicans off against Democrats when they're two masks on the same face. We have to change, because if we don't, what they want will unfold, and what they want is absolutely horrific. It's time to stop being children in adult bodies and start to stand up together and face this. And if we do, we can bring it to an end, because we have the numbers. There are 7 billion plus in this world, divided and ruled through all these fault lines I'm talking about, but there is a handful, comparatively, of people at the core who are orchestrating all of this. Now, we, the 7 billion, have not come together in unity because the few have divided and ruled us and set us at war with each other. Economic competition, military competition, competition for dominance of religion and belief system. When we let that go, the unity of the mass of the people can swamp the pinprick number at the core of the core who are orchestrating this. Time is now. Fork in the road is in front of us, and we have no time left to decide which way to go. Well, if you can't put your differences aside, I tell you what we ought to do. Tell you what we'll do. When people are in the concentration camps, and when their children and grandchildren are having every detail of their lives, even their thoughts, dictated by this global tyranny that's unfolding, I tell you what we should do. We should all sit around, before they take us to bring an end to us all together, we should all sit around and we should have a debate on who had the best religion, who had the best politics, who had the best belief system, who had the most money. That's what we can do. That'd be a great idea, wouldn't it?
And then we can have
that
a
has
head
to happen now.
Yeah.
It has to end now, because if it doesn't,
Nike. And realize that all those hierarchies are the same freaking hierarchy. Let's come together. It's their worst bloody nightmare. This is why America and Israel work as one unit. They're both controlled by the same bloody lot. This is why he won't say a word, or any other president, when this mayhem and slaughter is going on. What's happening in Palestine is freaking genocide. No other word for it. Genocide, the systematic and widespread extermination or attempted extermination of an entire national, racial, religious or ethnic group. This is Rothschild Zionism, this is Rothschild Zionism, so is bloody this. All the time, Palestinian homes, often for generations, bulldozed to make way for these bloody fanatics and these bloody crazies in the military and government. Yeah, we're going to build a wall. We're going to take the land. No one's going to say anything. This is bloody Israel. Controlled by the Rothschilds. No one says no to the Rothschilds. They know the consequences. Hey, Palestinian children's playground. We want it for our wall. Genocide. Bloody genocide. This is Palestinian land, the green, in 1946, 1947, 1967. Today. Genocide, the systematic and widespread extermination or attempted extermination of an entire national, racial, religious or ethnic group. This is going on before our eyes. We'd never let it happen again. We're watching it happen again. The bloody Zion, bloody Olympics, new bloody Jerusalem, Zion. This is not even about Jewish people and the benefits. They were hung out to dry in bloody Germany. They'll be hung out to dry again. Whenever it suits these people. That's the bloody thing. The elephant in the living room. And people are terrified of talking about it. Because all the Anti-Defamation League and these Rothschild fronts jump on you. Anti-Semite, racist. They've tried it with me. But when you're saying we're all infinite awareness, having an experience, and the genetic spacesuit is fucking irrelevant, well, it's very difficult to make it stick. And even if it does, I don't bloody give a shit. So, we have this and we have this, and yet we must be scared of Iran. Personally, I think it's more likely we should be scared of America and Britain, myself. And Rothschild Zionism want to take us, the Rothschilds and Rothschilds, I want to take us into being done to weaken and weaken and weaken the target population, Fabius style, so eventually they think they can just walk in when we're too weak to resist. That's the bloody idea. Physical control. I'll get through this pretty quick. Physical control, okay, major aspect of physical control, take over the countries. This is not a map, it's a wish list. It's a wish list of countries in North Africa, the Middle East and the Near East, which they are picking off one after the other. Libya, now they're into Syria, they're starting trouble in Lebanon, they're in Iraq, they're in Afghanistan, of course they want Iran. And what they're doing is they're finding different excuses to pick off different countries, because they have to find different excuses, or people might think that there's a pattern here. This is what Libya looked like in 2007. This is what the same street looks like in 2011. This is Libya. Hey, you are free. And this is what happens when you pepper bomb cities to protect civilians from violence. What happened? I got no brief for bloody Gaddafi and all that stuff, but that's not the point. What happened was that they've got this system where they want to target someone. So what they do is they fund and train rebels covertly, and they bloody arm them. And then they get the rebels to start shooting at government targets. Political response, shh. Media response, shh. Then the governments start shooting back at the rebels. Political response, they're shooting and killing their own people. Media response, the same. Oh, we've got to send people in, humanitarian. And in come the de facto bloody world army, NATO, dropping bombs everywhere. And now they're doing the same in bloody Syria. Not a Syrian civil war, it's a mercenary bloody war. That's what that is. You know, NATO bloody weapons here in the boxes for them. And you know this neocon organization, the Project for the New American Century, it was behind the Bush administration. And in September 2000, before the Bush administration came in, it produced a document which called for the incoming Bush administration and America to fight, quote, multiple theaters of war in places like Libya and Syria and all these countries. But it said in the document in September... And of course, one of the things they want is to get to the China and Russian border. They want a third world war with China and Russia. It's been in their documents for ages. And so what we're seeing are these people going through the Middle East using different excuses to pick off their target countries. You know, oh, America stands for freedom. We want to protect Brazilians. We only care about peace. Ah, only kidding, only kidding. She's Hillary speaking. No, I just love it. Ooh, yes, I love it. Syria next, kill them. Oh, I love it. There you are, that's bloody NATO. There you go, I like that. Here we go. So we look at Iran. We look at Iran, and this is how many wars they have instigated or fought since the Second World War. Actually, that's how many they've instigated and instigated for about 200 bloody years. This is how many the USA has fought with Britain in tag most of the bloody time since the Second World War. These are American bases around Iran. Who's threatening who, one wonders? Iranians are just the same as you and me. People just want to get on with their lives and their families and all the rest of it. But let's demonize them. Let's demonize them and let's bomb them. Why? We have no heart. We love death. These bloody pillocks doing all this stuff. Violent extremists. Yeah, look in the bloody mirror. Look at them. Talk about inversion. The bloody terrorists fighting terrorism. I love it. War is peace. Slavery is freedom. Ignorance is strength. What is that? Archontic inversion. It's all that bloody movie that we're coming through, and it's all leading up to World War III. I'm not going to go into this in bloody detail because of time, but Rothschild Zionism, which is actually not about Jewish people, it's about a secret society created and instigated and controlled by the Rothschilds that the Jewish people has used as the bloody front to cover the real thing about Rothschild Zionism, which is it's a bloody secret society and part of the cabal. But the Rothschilds, you know, named after Saturn and all this stuff, they built the Knesset, they built the Supreme Court building, and what they do is that they anyone that challenges Rothschild, the Rothschild lady says anti-Zionism is not anti-Semitism, and even bloody Orthodox Jewish rabbis are saying the bloody same. You don't have to be a Jewish to be a Zionist. That's what Joe Biden said. Absolutely you don't. Most bloody great, you know, Zionists in America are Christian bloody Zionists, believing bloody Armageddon. And you get Orthodox Jews that absolutely oppose Zionism. You know, another Jew against Zionism. I'm Jewish and I want Israel to stop killing Palestinians. Jews against the occupation. These are wonderful Jewish young people that refuse... These are wonderful Jewish young people who refuse to serve in the military and do this to Palestinian bloody kids. That's what we need. How many people know that this is going on between Jewish people and Ahmadinejad? Hey, how many people know this is going on? This is the dynamic between a country of 300 plus million and one of less than 8 million. Why? Because the Rothschilds are the controllers of Israel and they're controllers of the USA and they're different hands on the same bloody body. And it's all this money that's handed by America to Israel. It ain't going to the rank and file Israelis. This is 400,000 people on the streets of Israel last year because of their economic situation. Two people at least have set fire to themselves in bloody protest. And what we bloody need so much is for the people of Israel who are being suppressed by their bloody hierarchy come together in common cause with Palestinians and Americans and British and Australians and Africans who are being suppressed by their hierarchy. And realize that all those hierarchies are the same frickin' hierarchy. Let's come together. It's their worst bloody nightmare. This is why America and Israel work as one unit. They're both controlled by the same bloody lot. This is why he won't say a word or any other president when this mayhem and slaughter is going on. What's happening in Palestine is frickin' genocide. No other word for it. Genocide, the systematic and widespread extermination or attempted extermination of an entire national, racial, religious or ethnic group. This is Rothschild Zionism. This is Rothschild Zionism. So is bloody this. All the time, Palestinian homes, often for generations, bulldozed to make way for these bloody fanatics and these bloody crazies in the military and government. Yeah, we're going to build a wall. We're going to take the land. No one's going to say anything. This is bloody war.
The martyrs of history were not fools. The martyrs of history were not fools. By committing an immorality so great, eventually, we have to face the final demand, the ultimatum. Eventually, we have to face the final demand, the ultimatum.
And of course, one of the things they want is to get to the China and Russian border. They want a third world war with China and Russia. It's been in their documents for ages. And so what we're seeing are these people going through the Middle East using different excuses to pick off their target countries. You know, oh, America stands for freedom. We want to protect Brazilians. We only care about peace. Ah, only kidding, only kidding. She's Hillary speaking. No, I just love it. Ooh, yes, I love it. Syria next, kill them. Oh, I love it. There you are, that's bloody NATO. There you go, I like that. So we look at Iran. We look at Iran, and this is how many wars they have instigated or fought since the Second World War. Actually, that's how many they've instigated and instigated for about 200 bloody years. This is how many the USA has fought with Britain in tag most of the bloody time since the Second World War. These are American bases around Iran. Who's threatening who, one wonders? Iranians are just the same as you and me. People just want to get on with their lives and their families and all the rest of it. But let's demonize them. Let's demonize them and let's bomb them. Why? We have no heart. I just got this memo from the Secretary of Defense's office. It says we're going to attack and destroy the governments in 7 countries in 5 years. We're going to start with Iraq and then we're going to move to Syria, Lebanon, Libya, Somalia, Sudan, and Iran. And Clark said the aim of the plot was they wanted to destabilize the Middle East, turn it upside down and make it under our control. And that is the agenda that's been followed, and all these excuses to pick off country over country are just that, bloody excuses.
And they say if we'll only avoid any direct confrontation with the enemy, they call their policy accommodation. And they say if we'll only avoid any direct confrontation with the enemy, they call their policy accommodation. Because to save our own skins, we're willing to make a deal with your slave masters. Your slave masters. Because to save our own skins, we're willing to make a deal with your slave masters. There's only one guaranteed way you can have peace. Surrender. There's only one guaranteed way you can have peace. Surrender. And therein lies the road to war. And therein lies the road to war. Because to save our own skins, we're willing to make a deal with your slave masters.
By any means necessary.
To deliver the final ultimatum.
By any means necessary.
There is a price we will not pay. There is a point beyond which they must not advance.
By any means necessary.
To deliver the final ultimatum.
By any means necessary.
There is a price we will not pay. There is a point beyond which they must not advance. There's only one guaranteed way you can have peace. Surrender. There's only one guaranteed way you can have peace. Surrender. And therein lies the road to war. The martyrs of history were not fools. By committing an immorality so great, eventually we have to face the final demand, the ultimatum. Eventually we have to face the final demand, the ultimatum.
And of course, one of the things they want is to get to the China and Russian border. They want a third world war with China and Russia. It's been in their documents for ages. And so what we're seeing are these people going through the Middle East using different excuses to pick off their target countries. You know, oh, America stands for freedom. We want to protect Brazilians. We only care about peace. Ah, only kidding. She's Hillary speaking. No, I just love it. Ooh, yes, I love it. Syria next, kill them. Oh, I love it. There you are, that's bloody NATO. There you go, I like that. So we look at Iran. And This is how many wars they have instigated or fought since the Second World War. Actually, that's how many they've instigated and instigated for about 200 bloody years. This is how many the USA has fought with Britain in tag most of the bloody time since the Second World War. These are American bases around Iran. Who's threatening who, one wonders? Iranians are just the same as you and me. People just want to get on with their lives and their families and all the rest of it. But let's demonize them. Let's demonize them and let's bomb them. Why? We have no heart. We love death. These bloody pillocks doing all this stuff. Violent extremists. Yeah, look in the bloody mirror. Look at them. Talk about inversion. The bloody terrorists fighting terrorism. I love it. War is peace, slavery is freedom, ignorance is... I want Israel to stop killing Palestinians, Jews against the occupation. These are wonderful Jewish young people that refuse... These are wonderful Jewish young people that refuse to serve in the military and do this to Palestinian bloody kids. That's what we need. How many people know that this is going on between Jewish people and Ahmadinejad? Hey? How many people know this is going on? This is the dynamic between a country of 300 plus million and one of less than 8 million. Why? Because the Rothschilds are the controllers of Israel and they're controllers of the USA and they're different hands on the same bloody body. And it's all this money that's handed by America to Israel. It ain't going to the rank and file Israelis. This is 400,000 people on the streets of Israel last year because of their economic situation. Two people at least have set fire to themselves in bloody protest. And what we bloody need so much is for the people of Israel who are being suppressed by their bloody hierarchy come together in common cause with Palestinians and Americans and British and Australians and Africans who are being suppressed by their hierarchy. And realize that all those hierarchies are the same frickin' hierarchy. Let's come together. It's their worst bloody nightmare. This is why America and Israel work as one unit. They're both controlled by the same bloody lot. This is why he won't say a word or any other president when this mayhem and slaughter is going on. What's happening in Palestine is frickin' genocide. No other word for it. Genocide, the systematic and widespread extermination or attempted extermination of an entire national, racial, religious or ethnic group. This is Rothschild Zionism. This is Rothschild Zionism. So is bloody this. All the time, Palestinian homes, often for generations, bulldozed to make way for these bloody fanatics and these bloody crazies in the military and government. Yeah, we're going to build a wall. We're going to take the land. No one's going to say anything. This is bloody Israel. Controlled by the Rothschilds. No one says no to the Rothschilds. They know the consequences. Hey, Palestinian children's playground. We want it for our war. Genocide. Bloody genocide. This is Palestinian land, the green, in 1946, 1947, 1967. Today. Genocide. The systematic and widespread extermination or attempted extermination of an entire...
Stranded in the sand.
Now, the Fabian Society was actually named after a Roman general called Fabius, and his claim to fame was never having battles with the enemy that could prove decisive either way. His method of taking over was to weaken and weaken and weaken the enemy over a period of time, and then when they group, this is going on before our eyes. We'd never let it happen again. We're watching it happen again. The bloody Zion, bloody Olympics, new bloody Jerusalem, Zion. This is not even about Jewish people and the benefits. They were hung out to dry in bloody Germany. They'll be hung out to dry again whenever it suits these people. That's the bloody thing. The elephant in the living room. And people are terrified of talking about it because all the Anti-Defamation League and these Rothschild fronts jump on you. Anti-Semite, racist. They've tried it with me. But when you're saying we're all infinite awareness, having an experience, and the genetic space suit is fucking irrelevant, well, it's very difficult to make it stick. And even if it does, I don't bloody give a shit. So, we have this, and we have this, and yet we must be scared of Iran. Personally, I think it's more likely we should be scared of America and Britain, myself. Rothschild Zionism want to take us, the Rothschilds and Rothschilds, I want to take us into the Third World War. I've been saying this for years. And of course, Armageddon is supposed to come out of the Middle East. Third World War, it's all about death. All of them were Rothschild Zionists in the Project for the New American Century that orchestrated all this country after country takeover. But this guy, Albert Pike, was a high, high Freemason in America. And he wrote a letter, it said, some would say it's a forgery, or a fake. Well, my God, I tell you what, these fakes and forgeries don't often tell a bloody tale with the hindsight of history. That's actually turned out to be true. Albert Pike, letter to Giuseppe Mazzini in 1871, he talked about three world wars coming, so that and each one would go towards eventually taking over the world. And he talked about the First World War and the Second World War and how the Second World War would create a homeland for what he called political Zionism. And then he said this about the Third World War. The Third World War must be fomented by taking advantage of the differences caused by the agentura of the Illuminati, the network, the bloodlines, between the political Zionist, Israel in other words, and leaders of the Islamic world. The war must be conducted in such a way that Islam, the Muslim Arabic world, and political Zionism, the State of Israel, because they knew that was coming even then, mutually destroy each other. Meanwhile, note that, mutually destroy each other. Are you listening, people of Israel? Meanwhile, the other nations, once more divided on this issue, will be constrained to fight to the point of complete physical, moral, and spiritual and economical exhaustion. And then he was pointing out that then they would move in and say, we can save everything, but you have to do what we say, and they have to do it the way we say it. And if it becomes a bloody weapons here in the boxes for them. And you know neocon organization, the Project for the New American Century, it was behind the Bush administration, and September 2000, before the Bush administration came in, it produced a document which called for the incoming Bush administration and America to fight, quote, multiple theaters of war in places like Libya and Syria and all these countries. But it said in the document, in September 2000, but this process of transformation, this takeover of country after country, was likely to be a long one, absent some catastrophic and catalyzing event like a new Pearl Harbor. 1 year to the month after that document was published, 9 months after the same people came to power in the Bush administration, the United States had what Bush called our Pearl Harbor, and as a result, they justified the targeting of all the countries that were in that document. This is a man called General Wesley Clark, and he said this in a television interview. This is not God's gift to peace either. He led the NATO attacks in the former Yugoslavia, but He said in a television interview in 2007 that immediately after 9/11, he was told that a coup was being plotted by Dick Cheney, vice president then, Don Rumsfeld, defense secretary, Paul Wolfowitz, defense secretary deputy, and what he called a half a dozen other collaborators from the Project for the New American Century that included an invasion of Iraq. 6 weeks later, he said, he was back with the guy, and he saw the same officer, and he said, why haven't we attacked Iraq? Are we still going to attack Iraq? And this officer said to him, this is again, you know, after 9/11, 6 weeks, sir, it's worse than that. The officer pulled up a piece of paper off his desk and said, I just got this memo from the Secretary of Defense's office. It says we're going to attack and destroy the governments in 7 countries in 5 years. We're going to start with Iraq, and then we're going to move to Syria, Lebanon, Libya, Somalia, Sudan, and Iran. And Clark said the aim of the plot was they wanted to destabilize the Middle East, turn it upside down, and make it under our control. And that is the agenda that's been followed, and all these excuses to pick off country over country are just that, bloody excuses.
And they say if we'll only avoid any direct confrontation with the enemy, they call their policy accommodation. And they say if we'll only avoid any direct confrontation with the enemy,